words today are from Liz James, and I picked them because if you were here last weekend, Doug used stone soup as the message for all ages, and Liz writes this poem. I am not sure those townspeople were being selfish in the stone soup story. You probably remember how it goes. When the old woman came into the village and asked for ingredients to make food, everyone said they had nothing. She began boiling a pot of water with a stone in it and said, "Oh, I wish I had a little salt." And someone came forward shyly with a tiny bit tucked away in a pocket. Then she wondered out loud if she could find a few root vegetables, and another person had that. Someone else had a few spoonfuls of rice and so on until a glorious soup was made. We're taught that this tale is about tricking a meal out of selfish people. But I don't really think that's what happened. I mean, if someone asked me if I had a meal to share with them and I only had a half teaspoon of salt or a few old vegetables that are always at the back of my fridge, I would say I couldn't help. I wouldn't be lying when I said I had nothing to give. I would just be wrong. When we say that there's nothing we can do, we're not lying. That phone call we might make, that $5 we might donate, that quick email of encouragement we might send, these things feel so small that we think that they're the same as having nothing to offer. The stone soup story isn't about selfish people. It's about people who thought they were powerless. It's about people learning that they had something to offer that would feed themselves and each other. May we be given the bravery to step forward and offer whatever we have. May we be given the wisdom to see ourselves as part of something greater. And may we be given the compassion to see and draw out the gifts that are found in others. open question process at this time of year, how it fits into the cycle of governance. Today we're going to focus on abundance. One of the priorities of the interim time for this year and next is creating a culture of abundance here at FUS. And when I think about a culture of abundance, I immediately think of the classic stories, you can see my little graphic up there, of Jesus feeding the 5,000 with the loaves and the fishes. And you remember that one, right? Jesus is teaching and people are hungry and there's no food. And so he asks them to bring forth a basket of fish and a basket of bread, and suddenly there's enough food for everyone, for 5,000 people. Now, when I was hearing the story as a kid sitting in the pew at St. Pat's, it was told as a miracle story, pure and simple. And, you know, no questions asked. People were hungry. Jesus made food miraculously appear and spread far and wide. And it wasn't until I was in seminary that I had a professor who told us this story and then said, what is the meaning of it? And I was thinking in my head, it's a miracle story. It's one of those that proves Jesus is divine and nothing more to it. And then she started talking about how really it is a story of abundance and generosity and hospitality. It's the story of a community coming together to share what they each had. And she painted this beautiful image of people going into, you know, separate pockets in their bags to pull out just a little bit more that maybe they were setting aside for later. And that everyone, by giving what they had enough. And she said, it is a miracle story, but it's not a miracle story of one person. It's the miracle of community. Because when each person gives what they have, we have enough. And that sort of, you know, when Doug is talking about creating a culture of abundance, that's what I think of. That a community of abundance is when we come together, and out of this spirit of generosity and gratitude for all the goodness in our lives, we share and we realize that together we have and that we are enough. So we're talking about abundance today. It is a priority of the interim time. It is also what the board's going to be focusing on a strategic level for the coming year. And so for that, I'm going to turn it over to my co-conspirator. We need a theme song. It's now the Terry part, the Terry and Kench.
We do need a theme song, so I'm going to talk about governance for just a minute here. Consultant and governance expert Dan Hodges. and the cadence of the planning activities, long-range planning, and in particular the communication channels between board, ministers, staff, and the congregation. And the open questioning process is one important point of connection between the board and the congregation. So basic definition, the open questions are designed to gather the information needed for strategic planning. So the board hosts conversations, as we're doing today, to listen to each other and gain a sense of the congregation's most important priorities. But the question and topic that we'll talk about today are something we'll talk about not just here in this meeting, but something that we'll come back to in many other settings, and something that we'll also discuss at our board meetings. The question before us today is quite broad, but the eventual outcome of these conversations is to lead to setting more concrete strategic goals. And the intent is to be very forward-looking, so we're actually thinking now about goals that we might want to set for future years. So moving into the conversation on the open question today, Kelly's going to help divide us into groups, roughly 7 of us.
She's laughing hysterically because we have a divide. She doesn't think it can be done. So you need to prove me right on this one. Do we have an attendance number?
71.
Okay. So could the board members stand up? Or board members, if you would come up here. Board members are going to help record what's happening in the groups. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I think there's 6, 7, 8 with Mike. Okay, awesome. Let's do
about just kind of images, words, phrases. This isn't the part of the conversation that we're really collecting. It's really just a reflective exercise. So, however you interpret the idea of abundance, what do you see here today? So we'll just take about 15 minutes for this part of the conversation, and I will bring the gong toward the end of that to bring us back together.
Thank you.
Yes, oh, sorry. Kelly's clarifying. Stay in your roots, but just wanted to check in verbally if folks could just shout out like one word or short phrase themes that came up.
The staff.
Thank you.
hope that wasn't Michelle's idea. She's in trouble. Panorama? I don't have a wine.
No, you don't. I do. It's my advocate for the camera system.
The mum looks really nice.
Thank you. this was the first time we actually divided by numbers so that all the groups were the same size and we were sitting with just whomever. And that was fantastic. In every other time we've met, I think there have been some groups of 7, some groups of 14, some groups of 25.
We could count to 8.
And we could actually count to 8 and get them all the same size.
So it was good to have groups of similar size.
I was amazed by the intelligence and creativity of my group. We had so many good ideas. Thank you.
Intelligence and creativity, experience within the group.
We were sitting up in the front corner, and the microphone from there to that corner was utterly unintelligible.
Okay, so there's some sound issues in this.
Yes.
Room. Huh,
surprise.
I found out that one idea might lead to another idea, and getting to know each other by working together was wonderful.
We got to know each other by listening to each other's ideas and having them play off of each other.
Wonderful ideas for being with the youth leaders. So I was grateful to be in that group.
Love to be with the youth leaders, getting new ideas.
Thank you, youth leaders.
Remember, too, to be grateful.